steps involved in investigation of outbreaks. Please note that to achieve the last learning outcome, there is another lecture recording which you all need to listen to in order to understand the detailed steps of outbreak investigation. In today's session, I'll only be outlining and listing the steps which are involved. So let's begin in understanding what is the concept of disease control. When we use the term disease control or control of diseases, it describes activities which are aimed at reducing the incidence of disease. Incidence refers to occurrence of new cases of a disease. So when we say that a particular disease has been controlled in the community, it means that there are no longer new cases of the disease occurring. Second is reduction in the duration of the disease and ultimately the risk of transmission, which means that if a person who is suffering from disease is treated, the duration of his suffering or symptoms automatically gets reduced, and by this we are able to achieve interruption of transmission. The risk of the agent being transmitted from that person to a susceptible host is taken care of. The third thing is by reducing the effects of the infection. Now, any particular disease might have physical or psychosocial complications. So by reducing or by controlling the disease, we are trying to reduce the effects of the infection. And finally, this also reduces the financial burden to the community. Now, how does this happen? When we are sick, we stay away from work, and staying away from work or absence from work means loss of productivity to the industry in which the person is working. By this way, there is a financial burden. By reducing the disease, by reducing the occurrence of disease, or by controlling the disease, we can reduce the financial burden to the community. So this is the concept of disease control. Now let's move on to understanding what are the principles of disease control. With reference to this, we need to understand three terminologies. The first one is control, which we have already looked at. Control basically emphasizes on reduction of disease incidence. We do not want new cases of the disease to occur. That is the concept of control, or that is the principle behind achieving control. The second one is elimination. When we talk about a disease which has been eliminated, it means that the infectious agent no longer exists in the human host. So we cannot find the infectious agent inside the human host. It means it is eliminated from the human host. Whereas the term eradication refers to complete removal of the infectious agent or the organism in all its forms. It could be either spore form or a vegetative form, and this happens not only from the human hosts but also from the environmental reservoirs. So we are removing the organism completely from wherever it can be found or wherever it can survive. So that is eradication. So if you look at the process, when we are looking at eradication, we first need to achieve elimination. And before achieving elimination, control is very, very important. But these all three essentially form the principles of disease control. Now let's look at a bit of detail about elimination and eradication. When we talk about disease elimination, we are talking about interrupting the transmission of disease. This is very important because when we talk about elimination, we can see here that there is disease transmission occurring, but we are planning to interrupt it. We are planning to stop it. Examples of disease elimination are elimination of the disease measles. Now measles is a viral infection which is spread by the respiratory route, and it affects young children. By vaccinating maximum number of younger children, we have been able to remove occurrence or existence of the measles virus from these children. So that is elimination of measles. Another example is diphtheria. The elimination of diphtheria, which is a bacterial infection caused by Corynebacterium diphtheriae, it also affects young children, and by giving the vaccine, we have been able to eliminate diphtheria from large geographic areas. Point to remember here is, as we go on achieving more and more elimination across different regions, we are very close to eradication. So it is said that regional elimination is a very important precursor, that is the step before eradication. So what is then disease eradication? Disease eradication has been defined as a process of termination of all transmission of infection by extermination of the infectious agent. Earlier we saw that in elimination, it talks about interruption of transmission, whereas eradication talks about termination, end of all transmission. And how do we achieve this? By removing the infectious agent. How is the infectious agent removed? That is through managerial techniques known as surveillance and containment, which we will learn in a moment. Disease eradication implies that this disease which we are talking about will no longer exist or no longer occur in the population. And the best example of eradication so far has been smallpox, which was a viral disease. So now when we say that smallpox has been eradicated, it means that no longer does smallpox virus exist, both in the humans as well as in the environment. So that's about elimination and eradication. Now let's actually look at what are the methods of disease control. As you can see here, there are five methods which have been given under disease control. First is elimination of reservoir. So you remove the reservoir, or rather you remove the place where the organism can survive and can multiply and replicate and be ready for transmission. Second, interruption of transmission. Third, protection of the susceptible host. Fourth is surveillance and containment, and last is notification and legislation. Of these five, the first three, that is elimination of reservoir, interruption of transmission, and protection of the susceptible host, are linked to the chain of infection. If we want to achieve these methods of control, we are essentially breaking the chain of infection. So looking at the chain of infection, we have the reservoir, the agent, mode of transmission, susceptible host. So we are going to target three areas of this chain of infection and break the chain of infection so that transmission doesn't occur. So first is elimination of the reservoir. Now, reservoirs, as we all know, could be human, plant, environmental, animal, anybody. So if we are able to eliminate the reservoir or the place where the organism can stay, multiply, survive, then we can largely achieve disease control. So for example, if we have a person suffering from tuberculosis, how do we eliminate this person access the reservoir for tuberculosis? How do we eliminate this reservoir? By treating the person so that no longer mycobacterium tuberculosis can be present in that particular individual. And if there is no agent, there is no question of transmission occurring. So this is just one example of how we can eliminate the reservoir. The second could be elimination of an environmental reservoir. For example, if we have breeding sites for mosquitoes, if we could remove those breeding sites, we can largely eliminate the reservoir and essentially we can achieve disease control. The second could be interruption of transmission. So what if we are not able to eliminate the reservoir and the agent is already present in the environment? So we can achieve interruption of transmission by targeting the mode of transmission. So if it is going to be mosquitoes as the mode of transmission, we can reduce the number of adult mosquitoes or the breeding sites so that the transmission is interrupted. So the virus or the agent we have multiplied, but if we reduce the vectors which are going to transmit the virus, we can still achieve control. And last one is protecting the susceptible host. Now what if we are not able to eliminate the reservoir completely or we are not able to interrupt the transmission, we can focus on protecting the susceptible host. Take the example of dengue again. Protecting the susceptible host for against dengue would be by using mosquito repellents, using mosquito treated bed nets, or using screens for the windows, using long sleeve clothing, etc. By doing all this, we are able to reduce the contact of the susceptible host with the vector, so that when there is no contact, there is no question of transmitting the virus from the vector to the susceptible host. So these are components of breaking the chain of infection. Now these were the first three parts of methods of disease control. Now moving to the next two, before we touch on surveillance, we need to understand one more terminology which is used interchangeably with surveillance, and that's called as monitoring. Now monitoring is considered to be the performance and analysis of routine measurements, routine which are done regularly or can be done every day. And why do we need to do it? So that we are able to detect any changes either in the environment or in the health status of the population study. Let's look at examples. Now this first one is a map which shows you few numbers, and you can see that around every number there is a color. Now this is a map which shows you the API or the air pollutant index in different states in Malaysia. Some time ago there was this problem of haze whereby the environment was highly polluted and the outside air was not of good quality for us to breathe. How did we know whether the air is of good quality, whether we should go out or we should stay indoors? This was done with the help of daily monitoring of air pollutant index, which was suggesting the quality of air in the environment. So depending on this index or the value, as you can see there in the circle, people were instructed whether they can leave their homes or they need to stay indoors. Now this is a very important change which was detected in the environment, and this change, because it was likely to affect the health of humans, so depending on whether the API was high or low, people were advised whether they can go out or stay indoors. This was a very important preventive step, and it is being done routinely. It is being done every day, every minute. So that is about API. Another way of monitoring an environmental change is this. This is known as a water sampling point, this particular structure. Inside there will be a pipeline carrying water, which will carry water to people's homes for domestic use. There is a place whereby, in this particular sampling center, whereby water will be collected and it will be sent for physical, chemical and microbiological investigation. Now this is very important because the water which is going to reach us and we are going to use it, whether it is safe to use or not, is being detected by sampling water from this water sampling unit. And this is a part of water quality monitoring, because this is for the safety and health of large populations of people across a particular region or the whole country. So these were two examples whereby we said that we are monitoring the environment and the changes to check whether it has got an effect on the health of populations. The next one is this. This is a chart which shows plotting of weight and height for age of children under 5 years. So as you can see, age is given across the x-axis and along the y-axis is the weights and the height of children. Now, this monitoring is done right from birth until 5 years of age. Every month, the child is brought to the healthcare facility and his weight and height is taken. And this is plotted on this graph and against these reference lines. So if the child falls along this line, it means the growth and the development of the child is appropriate. But if this line starts deviating from what is considered as normal, we can say that this child is having problems with growth and development. These problems can be identified early and complications can be prevented. So that is the rationale behind doing growth and development monitoring for children. So please do remember, monitoring is for routine measurements which can be done either for environment or for individuals. Now let's move on to what is surveillance. Now surveillance is ongoing, systematic collection, collation, analysis and interpretation of data. Now what is this data all about? This data is all about different changes in disease trends, or it could also be disasters, or it could be any forthcoming emergency. And this data is collected. It is ongoing. It never stops. It is collected. It is organized. It's analyzed. And this data is then converted into information, which is interpreted and it is disseminated to the relevant people or agencies. So These basically summarize surveillance as information for action. We are creating information so that some action can be taken to protect the health of people at large. Following are the objectives of surveillance. First, to provide information about new and changing trends in the health status of a population. Now, the word trend means that we have to have an ongoing system whereby we can check what is happening to a particular disease or a condition. For example, how do we know that dengue is always present in a particular population, or dengue has a seasonal occurrence, the number of cases will rise during a particular season? This is by collecting data regularly about dengue, about the number of new cases, about the deaths, and about the localities where dengue is more prevalent. Second is to provide timely warning of any public health disasters. So this is very important to identify that there could be an emergency or a disaster. If we can identify it early, we can plan interventions or we can plan activities so that many people can be saved or many people can be protected against the disaster. And last and very important objective is, based on this system, we can provide feedback to the policymakers from the Ministry of Health so that if there are any existing programs which do not work or they need to be modified based on the surveillance data, they can be modified so that the objectives which are designed for that program could be redefined or they may have to be changed depending on the surveillance data. So these are the objectives of surveillance. Let's now look at what is the surveillance system for dengue in Malaysia. As I have already mentioned, there is an app known as iDengue, and you can also open it on the website, and you can see the real-time picture of dengue all across Malaysia. You can see the number of cases, number of deaths, the hotspot localities. Hotspots are nothing but the places where there is ongoing dengue transmission. Now, these are high-risk transmission areas. So if you find hotspot localities, the healthcare personnel will go and monitor whether they can reduce the risk of transmission in that particular area. So by a continuous surveillance about dengue, we can see how we can prevent occurrence of dengue or we can reduce the incidence of dengue. So this app is an excellent example of technology and surveillance where we can prevent the deadly disease dengue. This is called as a surveillance loop, whereby, as you can see, there are arrows going in one particular direction and nowhere does this stop. So how to explain the surveillance loop? This is the healthcare system or your hospitals or healthcare units from where an event or a disease is reported to the surveillance center. Now, surveillance center is a place where all the data from different hospitals and different healthcare units will be collected. It will be organized or collated and analyzed, as well as interpreted, converted to information. Now, this information is then fed back and recommendations are given for action to the relevant agencies. And this continues. So that's why this is called as a surveillance loop. There is no point of time when this surveillance system stops. That's why we use the word ongoing when we define surveillance. So this, in a nutshell, is the Ministry of Health Malaysia surveillance systems. Point to be understood over here is, there is a system which we are going to talk about today, which is known as mandatory notification of disease surveillance, which is also called as notification of diseases, whereby all the public and the private healthcare facilities, that is public healthcare centers and hospitals, private GP clinics and hospitals, they all are supposed to notify diseases to the nearest district health office, which in turn will disseminate the information to the state health department, and finally this information goes to the National Disease Control Division of the Ministry of Health. So as you can see, the system for notification of disease starts with the hospital or the healthcare centers, and ultimately this information reaches up to the National Disease Control Division. Other than the healthcare facilities, there are several other centers or several other agencies which are also involved as a part of MOH surveillance systems, and they are the laboratories. Then they are the clinic-based, community-based, and the zoonotic diseases or Department of Veterinary Services, which all, so as you can see, this is a network or this is a big surveillance system. And the work in these surveillance systems goes on continuously, it never stops. So let's move on to understanding a bit of history of communicable disease control in Malaysia. For the first time in 1971, the epidemiology unit was established in the Ministry of Health, which was fully operational only in 1996, followed by which there was an act known as the Prevention and Control of Infectious Diseases Act 1988 for notification of communicable diseases. As we saw earlier, we saw notification and legislation. So these two terms are very closely linked, because we as doctors are supposed to notify the diseases which have been listed in this list of 27 notifiable diseases. If we fail... Thank you.
Thank you.